So let me finish up with the third part of it, and I do that quite quickly. This is the present situation of ECAT technology. So what happened in 2014 was that some of those researchers that I pulled in at the beginning in 2011, wanted to do as conclusive experiment as possible with a new kind of a reactor that Andrea Rossi had invented, which was hotter than the previous one. The one I showed you before was boiling water up to 100 degrees then, and maybe heating the steam until 110 degrees centigrade. So the new reactor would be this kind of alumina core, which is oxide of aluminium, and reaching temperatures beyond 1,000 degrees centigrade. They had this reactor that Rossi had prepared for them in a neutral lab in Switzerland, and they run it for 32 days and in the springtime, in March or April in 2014. And after that, they had a sample of the ashes of the fuel inside and analyzed that. And they took some time, a few months, to write a report that was released in October in 2045, which is called 2014, excuse me, which is called the Lugano Report. This is one of the events that's been discussed most, because the Lugano Report until now has been downloaded like 150,000 or 200,000 times. And there is a blogger here in Sweden running a blog called Sifferkoll, sifferkoll.se, who published the report together with me in October. And he's keeping statistics of that, and he's seen those downloads coming from also from interesting organizations like BlackRock, which is a large investment company in the US. And what they basically said in that report was that they could prove excess heat, which is the sign of a nuclear reaction. Although that was disputed later, and rightly so, it was not really conclusive demonstration of excess heat, because the measurement methods were maybe not exactly calibrated as they should have been. But they also demonstrated at the analysis of the ashes that there had been isotopic changes. As isotopic changes means that the nuclei of the elements in the fuel had been changed. So one neutron or two neutrons or one proton had been added or taken away from the nucleus. And if that happens, that's a clear demonstration, a clear proof of a nuclear reaction, because it can't happen with a chemical reaction. And that was maybe the most important finding of the Lugano report. Even that finding was disputed, and some people criticized the experiment because Rossi had been present at the start of the experiment and at the end of experiment, opening the reactor and pulling out the sample of the ashes. And some people accused Rossi for having exchanged the samples and faked that. Although it's been demonstrated several times that this, the kind of isotopic change that will come out of that sample would have been extremely difficult to produce on a faked way. So this is one of the important things that happened, Lugano report. Then Tom Darden of Industrial Heat, this company that invested in process technology, appeared at the ICCF19 last year in Padua in Italy and made a speech where he clearly gave his support to the cold fusion community. And the collaboration between Tom Darden, Industrial Heat, and Rossi is also one important sign of this technology being commercially developed. And I'm going to come back to that. And also important was that Rossi received a US patent on his technology in August 2015. And since it has been very difficult to receive patents on anything connected with cold fusion, this patent was important. It's kind of particular, the patent, because the most explained reaction in the patent is how you release hydrogen. If you remember the first picture I showed, you had an inlet of hydrogen, where you fill the hydrogen before the experiment started. Now, lately, Rossi has instead, he got a chemical compound called lithium aluminum hydride, which when you heat a bond of that compound, it releases hydrogen. So you don't have to have the hydrogen canister before and fill hydrogen inside. The hydrogen is already placed into the fluid. But the patent describes exactly the components of the fuel and something of the reactor as well. Although the reaction in itself, which is supposedly a nuclear reaction, is not described in detail. The patent is still very important. What's happening as well, which is maybe the most interesting thing right now, is an experiment going on with a new one megawatt reactor that Rossi has produced in collaboration with Industrial Heat. The experiment started at mid-February in 2015, and it's running in the premises of a commercial customer, supposedly running an industry where he uses the heat from the reaction. And before he had the heat produced by gas or electricity, so he knew exactly how much he paid for that 1 megawatt of heat. And now he's using the heat from this plant instead. And it's running day and night, and it's supposed to be running for 1 year, which would finish the mid-February this year, within more or less a month or so. There have been continuously reporting from Rossi where he says what he is doing. And apparently the reaction goes on well. The plant is running well, although they have some difficulties with material aspects of the heat being released. And, you know, it's the first prototype yet. And some things have to be developed and changed over time. But the reaction seems to be quite stable. And as far as I know, from people that I trust very much who have been there, the process is running extremely well, probably with a COP, which is coefficient of a performance. That is the ratio between the energy input and the energy output, which lies around, before the first reactors that Rossi presented, we had a COP of about 3, 4, 5, maybe at the most. So you put in 1 kilowatt and you get out 6 kilowatt. In this case, the COP is supposedly between 50 and 100. And maybe even beyond. We don't know that because no official results are being reported yet. But that would mean that you put in 10 kilowatts, which goes also to the control system of the plant, and you get 1 megawatt of heat in output. The reactors being inside are of the old technology, producing heat at around 100 and 115 degrees Celsius. So it's not the hot one. And the basic difference is that if you have a higher temperature, you could produce heat, which is enough for running a turbine. So you could also produce electricity. At these temperatures, you only produce heat, which is good for heating and for some industrial processes. Anyway, and the amount of fuel in that plant, if it's the same kind of technology as it was in the beginning, would only be tens of grams, and it's supposedly the fuel has not been recharged since the beginning of the test almost one year ago. So it would have tens of grams of fuel producing 1 megawatt of heat for 1 year. That's very impressive. And I can also tell you that people who've been there told me that the container is placed on blocks of wood. So you can see there is nothing coming in from underneath. And it's controlled a 24-hour a day by cameras. And there is also, most importantly, an independent third-party certification institute controlling the measurements. And apparently this institute is making measurements with values that correspond very well with the values that Ross himself and Industrial Heat are pulling out from the plant. The important thing about this third party institute is that when the results will be ready after 1 year, Rossi and Industrial Heat would be able to communicate the results. And I hope they will be doing that, because if they do that, and if they can have this third-party institute say that this is what we have measured, a major third-party institute certifying that these are the values that we have measured. 1 megawatt of heat being produced for 1 year with this amount of fuel, with this amount of electricity putting being input. That would be the first time, I think, we have a result that could be communicated to a broader audience than the quite limited community of people following the development in low-energy nuclear reactions today. And that would be the first time, I think, when the discussion about what this could mean as a change in the energy industry and other industries outside this community. So I think this trial, many people with me believe that this trial, this test of 1 year, 1 megawatt is very important. Now, the last thing that's going on is the ECAT-X, which is supposedly a new kind of reactor that Rossi has been experimenting with since a few months. Now, the only thing we know about this are the things that Rossi tells us. But supposedly, it's a quite small reactor that doesn't produce only heat, but it also produces electricity. At one time, it seemed to me that he also talked about producing light directly from the reaction. But the part of producing electricity directly from the reactor is extremely interesting, because with a heat reactor producing only heat, if you would supposedly put that into a car, you would need some kind of process transforming that heat into, if it's very hot, you could have a turbine producing electricity, or you would use the heat with thermoelectrical generators to produce electricity at very low efficiency, or you would have a Stirling engine, which is kind of advanced steam engine, which could produce movement from heat. But it would be quite complicated. Then you would need to store the energy in a battery, because you don't have the quick response that you have in a internal combustion engine. So the roadway to roadmap to go to have a low energy nuclear reaction in a car would be quite long. If you can have electricity produced directly from this reactor, you could just charge a battery and run an electrical car, right, like the Tesla cars, with this technology within a very short time frame. So this is extremely important. But we know very little. There is no documentation, no validated reports or anything. And I hope only that when the results hopefully are presented from the 1 megawatt test in the end of February or the middle of March, we don't know exactly when, that Rossi will be able to demonstrate this publicly as well. And I would be very interested to see some demonstrations, because it would really mean a big difference. So what's also going on, and we must not forget that, is that we have a whole ecosystem that has been growing in the last few years, which is on the side of the ECAT technology. A very large interest has been growing into, as I told you, into the null and new nuclear reactions in the last few years. We have private and governmental research going on, mostly in US, Russia, China, India, Japan, and Italy. Very interesting projects. In Japan, for example, there is a new project where they look at low-energy nuclear reactions to treat nuclear waste through transformation of the nuclei to have turn it into other elements, and that way reduce radiation and the time that waste has to be stored. You have other companies, very interesting small commercial companies working with the low energy nuclear reactions. So the most interesting are maybe Brilliant Energy Corporation, which have also has also a commercial device being developed. And last thing I heard from the founder, Robert Goes, is that they hope to put a commercial device on the market this year without promising anything. But I mean, that's a very interesting aspect. Nick Energy is a company formed around the Italian researcher Francesco Piantelli, which is a long runner in this field. He's got a huge knowledge about the physics around nuclear reactions, low energy nuclear reactions, and supposedly also some setups that could be very interesting for technology development. Then you got large corporations like Boeing, Airbus, Mitsubishi, and Toyota doing research, and ST Microelectronics doing research and also experiments and some patent applications in this area, and governmental organizations like NASA. You got the Martin Fleischmann Memorial Project, which is an open science project, a group of people in Europe and US working with an experiment that would be conclusive and demonstrate that low energy nuclear reactions are actually valid. And they would distribute that experiment to academic institutions around the world that would be able to replicate it and thus prove that this is a valid technology, a valid phenomenon. And what they're doing is that they're sharing everything that they do in real time on the internet, experiments and discussions and data and everything. It's a very interesting new way of doing science as well. Then you got other organizations like LENR Cities, which is a Swiss organization doing something in between the private intellectual property model of industrial heat and the open science with Martin Fleischmann. They're creating kind of a walled garden with investors, industries, and researchers sharing knowledge and funding between each other, in that way creating a kind of community, internal community, where you could decrease the risk of being disrupted in your own industry when this kind of technology is turning your industry upside down. Then you got the Industrial Association for LENR, LENRIA, which was founded and presented at the ICCF last year. So this is just a part of the ecosystem. If you go to LENRIA, actually, if you look search for LENRIA, there is a more complete map of the ecosystem around cold fusion, low energy nuclear reactions today. So finally, just as a conclusion, I believe that what happened in 1908, when the Wilbur Wright, the Wright brothers, Wilbur Wright in Paris demonstrated the first motorized flight that was possible to fly, and people actually understood that it was not impossible. The same, what then was created was the air industry in a few years. The same thing might be close now, maybe with the results from under Ross's 1 megawatt, 1 year test that would be presented in March 2016. Maybe we're reaching a similar situation. It will be very interesting to see what happens this year. Also, I believe, as I said, that this event about the results being presented in March, maybe from the 1 megawatt test, could be a start of a more public discussion about the consequences of this kind of technology. That's why I launched a few weeks ago the New Energy World Symposium that I'm planning to hold in Stockholm June 21st this year. And as I've been saying on the website of the conference, I will hold this conference only if the results presented are conclusive and clearly positive from the 1 megawatt test. Or I could add that if I would see anything else that would be at the same level of conclusiveness and persuasive results that people could believe in at the same time frame, more or less. I think it would be exciting, really, to start to discuss the consequences for society, for industry, and for finance of this kind of disruptive technology that new energy nuclear reactions, commercially viable new low energy nuclear reactions, really are. And I think it's really high time that we start to discuss that. That's why I would like to make this conference in June in Stockholm. And with that, I would thank you all. That was the last thing at my presentation. You all know about my book. We heard that it's available at Amazon, actually in three languages now, English, Italian, and Swedish. And it's also available as paperback, also through Amazon. It's print on demand. And I hope, if things are going the way I think this year, that I will be able to do a third edition, maybe at the end of this year, with updates from the important events this year. So with that, I'll thank you all for the attention and for the long presentation that I did today.